Hello everyone, welcome to our next Myth++ seminar. I hope you can see my slides now in the full screen mode. So today I will talk about the joint work with Olga Anosova from our group. It is about density functions of periodic sequences. So as usual in our seminar, feel free to ask questions during the talk. So simply start talking, raise your hand, or type in the chat. I hope there will be, of course, time at the end for more informal questions after we stop recording. And in a sense, this is a practice talk for a conference next week where this paper will be presented. It will be discrete geometry and mathematical morphology conference in Strasbourg. Okay, I have a few slides, a few introductory slides that were mainly prepared for this conference, but since you have seen them already, so many of you, I'll skip rather quickly. So only reminding that our main motivation for mathematical methods here is the study of periodic crystals, and we can see the all types of periodic crystals. So organic on the left, so-called hexagonal eyes, or inorganic or metal organic frameworks on the right. So the formal mathematical definition of a periodic crystal is on that slide. And for anyone who came for the first time to our seminar, let me remind you that we consider we model a periodic crystal as a set, as a periodic set of points at atomic centers, because atomic nuclei are real physical objects. So it was actually the advice from our colleagues in chemistry to consider only atomic nuclei, but at least initially do not take into account bonds between atoms, which are theoretical abstractions of interatomic interactions, but not real sticks or strings or springs in the physical space. So to define a crystal and practically in the crystallographic information file, what we have is a basis of a lattice, and this basis generates a lattice as the infinite collection of linear combinations with integer coefficients. So if Ci are integer numbers, when we get infinitely many black dots, for example, in the square lattice, starting from the basis, standard orthonormal basis V1, V2. However, exactly the same square lattice can be generated by many other different bases, so-called primitive bases that span a unit cell. So unit cell here is also defined by linear combinations, but coefficients are now real numbers restricted to the interval between 0 and 1. Crystal patterns. Yes, Mois. So you're right. I have looked at the definition of this definition in the International Tapes of Crystallography. So indeed, crystal pattern is essentially this periodic set of points in dimension three. So I think in crystallography it's very natural to consider the three-dimensional case. So initially we didn't know about this word crystal pattern, so we continue using periodic point set also because it makes sense in a more general situation. So in any high dimensional space, and if you say crystal pattern, it might hint at dimension three or maybe dimension two, but not higher dimensions. But you are right, in dimension three, a crystal pattern is a periodic set of points obtained from a lattice and a motif. So we simply take a finite set of points in a unit cell called a motif, and then we shift this lattice by all motif points, which could be defined as the set of all sums, a vector from a lattice and a pointer from motif, or in different words, we take a lattice and shift it to shift the origin of this lattice to all points in our motif. So we get a finite union of initial lattices. So this picture on the right hand side shows that we can get essentially the same or equivalent periodic point sets by choosing either different basis and the motif, or even if you fix a basis with different motifs inside the same unit cell, we could get periodic point sets that are related, for example, in this case, by translation. So that's why it's important to clarify what we mean by equivalent or identical sets. And in crystal structures, yes, for crystal structures, we use the rigid motion or isometry as the strongest possible and practically reasonable equivalence relation, because when we have a solid crystal as a rigid object, then it makes little sense to distinguish it up to rigid motion. For simplicity, we also include reflections, but the sign of orientation is easily definable or detectable. So that's why we'll talk about isometric classifications. So this slide also reminds you of the concept of an invariant up to actually any equivalence relation. In our case, we consider isometries. So we are interested in a property or a function or a descriptor. In mathematics, it's called an invariant if this function or property takes the same value on all equivalent objects. So in our case, isometric crystals. So this definition could be written formally in several ways. So if two objects are equivalent, S and Q, then the invariant should take the same value. So that's one way to define. But also an equivalent way is the following line. If our invariant takes different values, then the objects should be not isometric. And this property actually justifies the usefulness of an invariant, because if an invariant takes different values, when it really distinguishes objects, so it can be practically used for classification. So for saying with 100% certainty that our objects are different. So the final introductory slide reminds that so of course crystallography in the past tried to define a reduced cell, a canonical cell, which is uniquely defined. And formally, of course, it is possible. So probably the best or widely used cell is Negli cell. However, under small perturbations, this cell can change. So this reduction becomes discontinuous. And this simple example can be extended actually to any real crystal. So take your favorite crystal, its minimal or reduced cell, and then double it in size and perturb slightly atoms in the second copy, and then the minimal cell simply doubles in volume. So that's why the new extra requirement for invariants defined on the previous slide is to change continuously under such perturbations. And these perturbations are motivated by the inevitable noise in our measurements. Okay, so finally, so let me now go to the new content. So the previous slide you have seen that reduced cell changes, but actually the density, so when, say the number of points in the geometric sense divided by the volume, or more formally in the physical sense, so the total mass of atoms in a unit cell divided by the volume of the cell. So this quantity might easily remain not only continuous, which is good, but also simply constant. So it is a good invariant. It's a good isometry invariant, but it gives only a single number and might not be changing under perturbations. For example, if our cell is fixed, but atoms simply shift a little bit within that cell, then the physical density remains the same. So that's why it was a motivation for us to extend with physical density to stronger isometry invariants. So a joint paper with Herbert Bruner and Phil Smith, who from our group, and other co-authors from IST Austria. So it appeared in Proceedings of Symposium on Computational Geometry last year. This paper extended the single value density to a much wider, much larger collection of so-called density functions. So the key idea is to consider not a fixed radius, but a variable radius. So why radius? If for simplicity, we imagine that we have atoms of the same type, say pure carbon as in diamond or graphite, then instead of mass of these identical atoms, we could actually consider volumes of balls. For example, volumes at a fixed van der Waals radius of these atoms. But in principle, well, this atomic mass is simply proportional to the volume. And in this formula, we could take volumes of balls centered at atomic centers, but for a fixed radius, and we get basically the same density or proportional to the physical density. So instead of taking a fixed radius, so what happens if you take, if you consider this radius as a variable, when this t can vary continuously from zero to any large number to plus infinity, and the cave density function here is formally defined as the volume of regions covered by exactly k balls with a fixed radius t, and centered at all points of our periodic set. So we restrict our attention to, again, a unit cell, and then divide this resulting volume by the volume of the unit cell. So we're interested basically in the fractional volume covered by exactly k balls. So let me show the picture, which hopefully clarifies this definition. So in the left-hand side here, you see a periodic point set with a square cell and a motif of two points inside. So this particular set is not a lattice. So the motif consists of two points, not a single one. So it is a union of two square lattices. And the pictures show what happens when we start increasing the radius of balls around our points. So when balls are initially small, then they simply do not overlap. So we have disjoint balls. But already for this value, exactly one quarter. So if our square cell has side one, then at this particular radius one quarter, two disks at our points intersect as shown in the left hand side picture. So the blue region here is covered by exactly one ball, and the green color shows a twofold intersection, where every point belongs to exactly two closed balls growing around our points. And you can imagine that the picture quickly becomes very complicated when we increase the radius. So already in the middle picture, so the value slightly more than one half, the regions covered only by one ball are very small, so the fractional volume have decreased. So only these regions far away from our initial points. And then we also have triple intersections shown here in the orange color. And for larger radii, we see with red four-fold intersections. So these regions intersections of four balls, and then this purple color is for five fold intersections, and so on. So this intersections become very quickly very complicated. However, let me first ask if there are any questions at this point. So on the definition, and also clarify what so it's hopefully easy for you to see what the resulting fractional volume that we compute is independent of a choice of a unit cell. Because if you, instead of a square cell, yeah, we choose a parallelogram, we still essentially compute the same fractional volume. So basically, with psi k, so the density function k, density function computes the probability that a random point belongs to exactly k balls. And in this probabilistic definition, we actually don't use any unit cell, but we should specify the probability density function. And it simply says that that the probability to get a point from a specific region in our space equals the fractional volume of this region with respect to the volume of a unit cell. Okay, so let me show these functions, intersections and corresponding functions for the square lattice. So initially, when disks are small and disjoint, then our fractional volume grows simply quadratically, because we are essentially computing here for small values of the radius t, simply the area of a disk. However, when these disks start intersecting each other, then it's no longer a quadratic function. It becomes more complicated, so it reaches its local maximum, global maximum in this case, at some point after 1/2. And then, so it's easy to imagine actually what for the first density function, yes, all regions covered by exactly one ball eventually disappear, because every point and will be soon covered by at least two balls. So already at radius one, there is no point on the plane covered exactly by one ball. So with functions, so this plot was produced by Phil Smith, and essentially it was computed for sampled values of the radius t, and then the visualization software simply joined them into a continuous function. But essentially what you see here is an interpolation of discretely computed values at different radii. So what is surprising here to see that the functions look rather complicated. So it's hard to predict, yeah, actually what happens next. So what will be the next function? Well, even what will be its, say, global maximum or rough shape. So let's look at one more example, like hexagonal lattice. So in this case, eight functions, the first eight density functions look differently. So also rather strangely or unpredictable behaving. And so the problem now becomes to understand with sequence. So formally it is an infinite sequence of functions. So for any integer k, you have a scalar function which gives us an invariant for every value of t. So here you have two parameters. K is the index, so the number of balls that we intersect, and t is the radius. And for every such pair, we get a single number, which is an isometry invariant. So as a result, we get actually a lot of numerical invariants of the original periodic point set. And indeed, so it was shown that it is a rather strong invariant. So before I go next, so let me explain maybe one more function, psi zero here. So psi zero is simply the volume, the fractional volume of the region of points covered by no balls at all. So initially this fractional volume is at 1 or 100%, then it goes down rather quickly. And for this particular function psi zero, it's actually almost obvious what this function monotonically decreases to zero, right? Because these regions form a natural filtration where regions not covered by any balls simply become smaller and smaller when the radius t increases. However, the same argument for any larger index k is not so simple. So it's natural to expect that, for example, psi one function, so it initially increases. Yes, it should have some local maximum somewhere, but it's not completely obvious that after this local maximum, psi one or any higher index function here will monotonically decrease. And I think Phil actually has specific examples when it doesn't happen. If you remember, how complicated are these examples? Do they happen already for say two-dimensional lattice, or you have seen these examples for more general sets, dimension two or three?
I'm afraid I can't remember, but I seem to remember Herbert had constructed some point sets, maybe in 2D, that satisfy that property. Okay.
So we could actually return to this question a bit later. Thank you. Thank you, Phil. So let me summarize actually what has been proved formally. So what is known and not known. So with density functions, so they look continuous with respect to the variable t, yeah, which is natural. So when we increase the radius, of course, all these intersections change continuously. But for us, it's even more important that they are continuous with respect to perturbations of initial points. So when we start perturbing points, then again, balls around them perturb continuously. So it's natural to expect that intersections and volumes of these intersections also change continuously. So this was formally proved in that paper from 2021 with a specific Lipschitz constant, that in the sense that if you perturb every point in its epsilon neighborhood in the three-dimensional space, then a natural distance between density functions, which is simply the maximum point-wise difference between the initial function and the function of the perturbed set, this maximum point-wise distance normalized a little bit by a factor depending on k. So this distance is not more than a constant times epsilon, which is the initial perturbation of points. Right. So bulk with strength. It was formally proved that if you take a periodic point set in general position, so which is a bit hard to define, but basically for every non-singular situation, periodic point sets in dimension three, so in this particular case, can be distinguished by formally the infinite sequence. So I think we didn't have any small upper bound on how many density functions are needed. Yeah, because it should actually depend on the complexity of the initial point set, but the whole infinite sequence is enough. So also there is an algorithm that can compute these density functions fast, but for a fixed radius, as I mentioned previously. So if you fix a radius, then you have a fixed configuration of balls, and in principle, we could intersect all of them, but there is actually a faster algorithm avoiding these k-fold intersections. And this was actually discussed in our MIF++ seminar 2 weeks ago, how to do it faster. But the interesting question, is it possible to compute with functions not by this finite sampling, not by simply taking specific values of a radius, but maybe even writing down a formula or analytic expression or a more explicit algorithm to draw these functions for all t, for all values of the radius. And since you have seen these examples in the dimensions, square lattice, hexagonal lattice, where functions look rather strange and not clear how they can follow simple formulae, so we considered the even simpler case of a periodic point set in dimension one, so which is a sequence, a periodic sequence in R. And now in this talk, you will see a complete answer to that question. So how we could draw the density function for a periodic sequence. Okay, if there are no questions at this point, yeah, let me continue. So that's the aim. Moise?
No, I mean, to the previous slide, I was wondering what you mean by these periodic point sets in general position. So because in crystallography, we speak about position, general or special position, we always refer to kind of, so to say, symmetry group. And here we have just periodic point sets. So I was wondering the general position, whether it has some special meaning. Moreover, what I have seen you, let's say, the previous illustrations that you have of these balls. So let's say what I see here, these are always you take, let's say, points or lattice nodes. So let's say your balls are centered at lattice nodes.
You are right, but in this particular example, we have a hexagonal lattice and balls, of course, at lattice nodes. In a more general case, for example, here.
Yes, here it is not. But I mean, then you have a kind of also tetragonal or square lattice where again it was taken, let's say, the lattice node. So, and that's why I could relate it to this general position periodic set. That's why I was asking.
So the square lattice, the hexagonal lattice, they are not in general position. They are very symmetric, so they have a high symmetry. So by general position, the formal definition is a bit complicated, but let me briefly describe it as so when we grow with balls, so it's important to so for reconstruction, it's important to know to extract some critical values from these density functions that tell us about relative positions of points. So for the square lattice or hexagonal lattice, these critical values, because of the extra symmetries, they are combined. So we have, for example, at one half. So exactly at one half, we have a local maximum of psi one, but also the important value for psi two when double intersections appear, right? So this is a coincidence, right? In general position, it doesn't happen. So it happens only in more symmetric periodic point sets. So basically, when all these critical values are for different values, for different radii, when it's possible to distinguish periodic point sets. But for high symmetry situations, when critical values coincide, then there is no theoretical proof. On the other hand, also we have no counterexamples in dimensions 2 and 3. When non-isometric periodic point sets have exactly the same density functions. But in dimension one, you will see such a counterexample later. Have I answered your question?
Yeah, I mean, I understand that in fact, what you refer to general position is exactly, or at least similar to what we refer in crystallography. So let's say it is a point that has no side symmetry or local symmetry.
Yes. Well, basically no side symmetry and some extra conditions. So it's even more, a bit more restrictive. but it is still a general position in the sense that if it perturbs slightly any periodic point set, then it becomes generic. So up to, under almost any tiny perturbation. So that, so this is a general concept of general position, but all non-general, so singular configurations, they form a so-called subspace of measure zero. So it still could be infinite, so contain infinitely many configurations, but we could go outside well easily. So in this sense, but okay, let me.
Thank you. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. So for a periodic sequence, we have now a simple situation because we have a period, our unit cell becomes an interval, and it is convenient to scale down this interval to the standard unit interval 0, 1. And then our motif of points is simply a sequence of numbers, which could be ordered. So P1, et cetera, PM in this interval 0, 1. So of course, all these density functions they scale accordingly to so they scale accordingly when we put the interval into this standard length 0, 1 length one. That's why it's convenient to consider this normalized situation. So on the left-hand side here, you see an example. Where the period, so the unit interval here is from 0 to 1, and you have three points at position 0, 1, 3, 1, 2. So that point one is already a repetition of point zero, so up to the slightest translation by one. So now, how about our balls? Our balls become simply intervals in the same real line that grow around with fixed motif points. So I show them here in different colors. So the red interval is around point zero. And as you see, it grows in this picture from two different sides, because remember, we grow balls from all points, but restrict our balls intervals here to the unit cell 0, 1. So that's why the regions covered by balls at interval centered at 0 and all its lattice translates here are shown in one color red. Okay, so the intervals are simply pi minus t, pi plus 2, pi plus t, but this interval is considered modulo 1. So that's why it here looks disjoint, but essentially it's one interval growing from point zero modulo lattice translations. Okay, so I will explain intersections here on further slides. I hope the initial step is clear. Okay. So let's start from this simplest function psi zero. So we are looking now at intervals, so regions that are not covered at all. So not covered by intervals of length 2t centered at other points. So, and of course, this region, so initially it's the full interval, except our points, but initially the length is one. So of course, this region shrinks gradually. And shrinks actually linearly. So it's linearly up to the first point. So up to the first point when intervals from two closest points collide. So this is the first singular situation. So the shortest interval between interpoint interval is here between green and blue points. So a radius is 1/12. And at that particular moment, so what happens? The region not covered by intervals is still shrinking, but at a different rate. So it is still a linear decrease, but this interval between 1/3 and 1/2, which was shrinking linearly, it is no longer involved. So it is already covered by green and blue intervals. So we are looking only at the two remaining black intervals. So that's why the rate of decrease changed, but it's still linear to the next critical moment when so the next critical moment is 1/4 when another pair of intervals of balls collide. So at least 1/4, what do we see? We see a collision of the blue interval and the red interval. So they touch each other, actually accidentally they touch each other on both sides. But what is important is what, so this particular, the next critical value, is one over six, when, the red and green interval start touching each other. Yes, and when finally we continue the linear decrease, when this remaining black interval is shrinking up to zero. So, so this example shows that it's important to understand with critical radii when we have collisions. And it is possible to explicitly write down with critical values. So that's a formal statement. So we start from a motif of points in the unit interval. We consider the length between successive points. So pi plus one minus pi. So this is a positive length between zero and one. And it is also convenient for this particular result to order our lengths between successive points, putting them in the increasing order. So these indices in square brackets, they not necessarily correspond to indices coming from points. For example, for these three points, so what do you see? We have the interval from 0 to 1/3, length 1/3, then length 1/6, and then the longest length 1/2, right? So, so in this particular case, so these indices D1, indices 1, 2, and 3 in square brackets, so they do not correspond to point indices. So that's why we denoted them differently. Okay. However, after these notations are introduced, the result says that psi zero is a piecewise linear function with the following corner points. So we specify the values of the radius t in the first coordinate and the corresponding value of psi zero. So this sequence of corner points specifies points in our diagram, and then we simply linearly connect that sequence to get the whole function. So of course, the first corner point is 0, 1. So that's the initial value of the radius t equal to zero. And we finish, so the function becomes zero at, so the final point here is 1/2 of the longest, so the length of the longest interpoint interval. Because when we have most distant points, so in in this example, it's 1/2 and 1, then with most distant points, the intervals centered at least most distant points, they collide, then everything becomes zero. So all points are now covered by our balls. So the final value of psi zero is zero. So in this particular example, so you see that if you substitute with distances into this formula, then you get exactly the expected corners of the function psi zero. Any questions on computing psi zero? Okay, then so the next function is psi one. It's a bit more complicated. So so let me explain it in parts. So psi one measures the fractional volume covered by exactly one interval. So initially, of course, it's easy. So initially we simply, everything increases linearly. But then we have again critical points when intervals collide. So for example, so which example is easier here? For the red interval, yes. So if you look only at the region covered by the red interval, so we have the linear increase. So this function eta r, so it counts only the fractional length of intervals covered by the red interval. So if you simply disregard points covered by green and blue intervals, looking only at the red, then what happens? So initially it is a linear increase up to the critical value when the red interval collides here with the green interval. So it's 1/6. So at this point, the linear increase stopped. So it stops. And what happens next? On this right hand side, the red interval continues to increase. But on the opposite side, with green interval, you see, is taken over, and the part covered only by red points by the red interval is decreasing at the same rate as the increase on the right hand side. So on one hand side, it continues to increase and cover more points, but on the left, it decreases at the same rate. That's why the function remains constant for a while until there is another collision. So in this case, on the left at 1/4. So when we have another collision of this red interval from another side, in this case with the blue interval, then the red interval decrease on both sides. So that's why the function goes down linearly to zero. So in this one-dimensional situation, I see it's possible to describe explicitly what happens. So linear increase, constant time, constant range, and then linear decrease. So we only need to specify when exactly this happens. So what are these critical values when it happens? And similarly for other intervals. So for the green interval and for the blue interval. And after we have understood each interval separately, we should simply take the sum, because the region covered by exactly one interval is simply a union, disjoint union of intervals of regions covered by red interval or disjointly by green interval or by blue interval. Okay, so let me show the main statement here. So it's written down roughly in the same form as for psi zero. So we specify what are the corner points of these trapezoid functions that describe the contribution of each point or the interval growing around each point. So we need only four corners for each trapezoid function, and as you see, all coordinates here are explicitly written down. So for the simplest case, k equal to one, when k is one, then this auxiliary parameter s is simply zero. So this sum is empty, s is zero. So of course, when we start from 0, 0, the initial origin. Right. So basically, what you see here, again, in the simplest case, k equal to one, you have a dependence on two successive distances, di minus one and di. And then the sum of these distances is again used in the fourth corner. So previously, for psi zero, we used every distance separately. So they were, in a sense, independent, but now we use pairs. So pairs are used, and then for higher values of k, so we have again di minus one, di plus k minus one. So it's formally a pair, no longer successive pair, but also we use, intermediate intermediate distances from that sum. So basically, we need to know more distances going in with subsequences. That's the key idea. So let me now show more explicit examples and actually much simpler properties. So the theorem was rather technical, but this theorem was important, the previous one, was important to understand that density functions in dimension zero actually are very nice because they have some interesting extra periodicity. So when we add the number of points m to the index k, then we get almost exactly the same density function up to a shift. So here 1/2 is half the period. So as usual, our unit cell is 0, 1. So we have this periodicity with respect to a shift by half a period. For example, so this picture shows a sequence from psi 1 to psi 9 for a specific periodic point set, which you will see a bit later, but you see periodicity, right? So psi 1 is essentially obtained from psi 0 by a shift along this interval. And this long interval is exactly 1/2, so with respect to the full period. Then we have also the extra symmetry. So if you consider indices only between 0 and m, then so the symmetry also, yeah, with respect to half a period, or more formally, so if you look at the functions, for example, here, psi 4 and psi 5, then yes, of course, we're symmetric with respect to that vertical line. And this vertical line is at 1/4 of the full period. So all these properties are not hard to derive from the explicit description in the previous theorem. So that's why it was important to understand it, to understand psi k explicitly. So what else could we do? So here the numbers refer to the items in the paper, so they're not very important, but the explicit description allows us to produce more formally, for example, for other scalar analogs of the initial physical density. So remember that physical density was a single number, and here we could consider other interesting scalar values. For example, the area under each density function is also an isometry invariant, can be computed explicitly. The formulae are much simpler than in previous theorems. So all these areas can be easily computed in terms of interpoint distances. So remember, these di are distances between successive points, so pi and pi minus one. Okay, so finally, the computational time. So again, it's a corollary of the explicit description. So we could draw the graph of the function, so the whole graph, so not at specific values of the radius, but the whole graph in a quadratic time with respect to the number of points in the unit cell. And we could also check whether such two graphs coincide in a cubic time. And so let me remind that in the three-dimensional case, so in the more practical case, the whole sequence of these density functions, they uniquely determine the periodic set in general position, but there are still no known counterexamples. But in dimension one, before going to dimension one, let me show that for dimension one, we could so this paper proves a stronger result in the sense that only psi one, only the first density function, is enough to uniquely determine a periodic sequence, but again in general position. And here the general position is easy to define, so it simply means that interpoint distances are distinct. So very simple. So any any distances between successive points are distinct, right? So in this particular case, the periodic sequence is uniquely determined up to translations and reflections, so up to isometry, so the real line only by psi one. And the idea is simple, so we simply look at critical values when this piecewise linear function psi one changes its gradient, and if all these distances are distinct, then from this critical values it's possible to obtain all these distances explicitly. And from these distances, of course, we reconstruct the periodic points, the periodic sequence uniquely up to shifts or reflections. Okay, however, let me mention the interesting computation, which was previously done only on a computer. So Phil has checked what for these two particular sequences, S15, Q15, so two sets, period 15, and 9 points in the motif. So these two periodic sequences are interesting because they were initially produced also as counterexamples to earlier older invariants in the paper by Greenbaum Moore in 1980s. And for the same pair, Phil has checked, I think, up to large numbers, so up to 40. But the first density functions coincide, but again, this was a numerical check at sampled values of the radius T. And the explicit description of a new explicit description of the density function now allows us to make this check explicit. So not by computation, but simply by manual calculations. So how could we prove that two infinite sequences of periodic density functions coincide? So first of all, we use periodicity with respect to 9 points. So remember, when we add 9 to k, then we get almost the same density functions, only shifted by half a period. And also there is a symmetry with respect to so for indices k and m minus k. So in our case, 9 minus k. So that's why. So it's enough to check what functions coincide only for the first 5 values. So if they coincide for k from 0 to 4, then they will continue to coincide for any larger k. So this is already a big reduction from infinitely many k to only 5 values of k. Then check what psi zero is the same for these two different periodic sequences, it's enough to look at sequences of distances. So these are the points in the top row of the table. And so for S15, for the first set, for the second, the points, and then in the next row, you see distances between successive points. So 1 minus 0 is 1. 3 minus 1 is 2, 4 minus 3 is 1, and so on. Right? So here we are written with respect to the points, so the same indices. But you remember for psi 1, sorry, psi 0, it was convenient to put one in increasing order. And when we put one in increasing order for these two different sets, you see what we get exactly the same increasing sequence of D. I in the square brackets, and that's why the functions psi zero uniquely determined by this ordered distances are the same. So that's the whole proof actually for k equal to zero. For k equal to one, slightly more complicated, we need now to consider pairs of distances. So so 3, 1, so what pair? So it's 3 is here, and 1 cyclically is the next distance. Then you have 1, 2, 2, 1, 1, 1, and so on. So this is a sequence of pairs of successive distances. And for another set, this sequence initially looks differently. But you remember in the formula, everything is unordered. So if you compare them as unordered sets, and also you could actually swap numbers in each pair, when that sequence actually coincides with this one. So after reordering and swapping distances. And that's why psi one again coincide for these two different sets. So for 2, 3, and 4, where computations are here a little bit more involved, but they still are doable on one page. So the tables are a bit long in the paper, but everything has been done manually. So now formally confirmed that these two non-isometric periodic sequences have exactly the same density function. So this is now a theoretically justified counterexample in dimension one. But the problem for high dimensions remains. So we still have not understood what happens even for two-dimensional lattices. So how these functions behave for higher dimensions. Okay, let me actually return to the main problem. The main problem was to distinguish or classify generally periodic point sets, but in dimension one, periodic sequences up to isometry. And some of you might have guessed already a long time ago, but the problem is actually simple. Our work, we consider density functions because they looked interesting and natural extensions of the physical density. But for periodic sequences, the isometry invariant is the complete invariant, simply the sequence of interpoint distances. So d1, d2, etc., considered in the cyclic up to cyclic permutations and reversion, this is a complete invariant. But the problem that it is unstable under perturbations. For example, you could consider all integer numbers z, or then you could slightly shift 1.1 to 1 plus epsilon and keep period 2. So we have now 2 points, 0, 1 plus epsilon, and then 2 plus epsilons, and so on. So this periodic sequence is nearly identical to the sequence of integer numbers, but formally this complete invariant now consists of two numbers. You have two interpoint distances, 1 plus epsilon, so a bit longer than 1, and 1 minus epsilon, a bit smaller than 1. And formally, this pair is no longer comparable to a single distance coming from the set of integer numbers, right? However, yes, it is possible to do one extra step and convert the sequence of distances into. So formally, we define a continuous metric on isometric classes of periodic point sets. And actually, our points are not necessarily longer in R in the line. Points can be in Rn, but one periodicity is still a restriction. So we still have, say, a vector which translates our periodic point set in high dimension, but to the same set. So it's not a full periodic case, it's still one periodic case, but points are not necessarily in the line. So this has been done in the more recent work. Okay, so I think at this point, actually I could stop because everything else is already known to our group. So thank you for your attention. Let me stop recording.